Yeah. Thank you. Hello. So all open source projects are free, so you can use it freely. But unfortunately, the cost of development is not really free. There is companies behind open source project. There is people behind open source project. And you have seen that OpenLayer 3 is really a great, fantastic product. It's really fantastic, awesome, what all the developers did. But they need a salary at the end of the month. So at some point, we need to finance also this project. So for OpenLayer 3, the development started officially in January, but several months before January of this year, we started a crowdfunding campaign. And I will explain a bit this procedure with the perspective of a founder, with the perspective of a customer or a user of OpenLayer. As a user, in my case, I am working by SwissTopo, and GeoAdmin is the Swiss GeoPortal and also the Swiss Spatial Data Infrastructure. Our target is simply to publish geodata to our citizens, to our companies in Switzerland. We have a Geoinformation Act. The law says that we need to do that, and this is the first article of the Geoinformation Act. And the main tool in order to provide this information to our user is the viewer, mapgeoadmin.ch. And this viewer contains about 200 geodata sets. This viewer is 3 or 4 years old. And this viewer was, from our point of view, outdated because we plan to create a 3D viewer. We have the whole Switzerland in 3D, all buildings, all streets in 3D, DTM with a 2 meter resolution, so we need to go in the third dimension, and also this software is not based on HTML5. Basically, this software is outdated. So, how can we create a new software? We are in an open source context, and we wanted really a complete new library. That was the original goal. In an open source context, we have this kind of person. We have users on the bottom, and we have the project steering committee on the top. Basically, we have the capacity to develop on the top, and we have the capacity to finance on the bottom. So how can we merge these two worlds? How can this person finance the work of the developer? The challenge was really to federate the developer on one side, to federate the founders on the other side, and of course, to formalize the relation between the founders and the developer. As a government agency, I need to have a contract, I need to have something. I can't simply say, oh, please develop, I give you money, and that's it. We need to have something formalized. So then came the idea of a crowdfunding effort, and you see in the definition of crowdfunding, we have also these two poles. On one side, we have someone who wants to make something, and on the other side, we have the money. So that's why we decided to go in a crowdfunding mode. That was the original idea. But there are several models of crowdfunding or funding. We can have a feature-oriented approach or a community-oriented approach, and I will try to explain these two approaches. Funding models, feature-oriented, it's simply you have a founder that needs a feature. He pays a committer who develops the feature, and at the end, it goes in the open source software. That's, I would say, a quite common approach. Another founder can do the same, and you have a new feature in the software. There are several advantages. It's quite agile. It's very efficient in bug fixing and for new development. But you have a lack of coordination. Of course, the open source community will discuss that. But between the founder, you don't have any coordination. And it can be that at some point, the feature is not accepted. And of our point of view, it's not very efficient for new development. Typical example, you have this platform, Bounty Source. You can provide money the bakers can provide money to developers, and you can ask for a feature. And with this platform, you can formalize this exchange between bakers and developers. There are other equivalent platforms. community-oriented model, it's a bit different. You have several founders that specify and that have some money and that discuss with an open source legal entity. It can be an association, it can be a consortium. Within this legal entity, you have the committers. And at the end, the committers can create code and develop open source software. We believe that this is interesting because there is a global responsibility on the legal entity. The legal entity is responsible for the new development. There is a kind of coordination on the legal entity. The developer committers are federated under this legal entity, and it's quite efficient for new development. The drawback are it needs a consensus by the founders, and it needs an agreement between the main actor of the open source community. And we believe also it's quite easy when you make simple bug fixing on or simple new small features. So I said at the beginning that we had three challenges. First of all, to federate the developers. In the feature-oriented model, the probability that development is not accepted is higher comparing to the community-oriented model. Because in a community-oriented model, you have all the main developers, so they will discuss together and they will also take the responsibility of this development. And you have also the question of homogeneity here. It's clear the legal entity, which groups all the main actors, is able to create a more homogeneous software comparing to a feature-oriented model. On the founder federation, on the founder side, in the feature-oriented model, it's very difficult to create a global feature list because every founder wants to make his own feature and doesn't care of the other. And that's the second sentence, the founder focus on their specific needs. In a community-oriented model, you have the possibility to agree on a global feature list, and you have the possibility to encourage the founding of other founders. Because if you have a feature list, and in the case of OpenLayer, it was quite easy, we said we want feature parity with OpenLayers too. And in addition, it has to be WebGL compatible. So this feature list was quite easy, not so easy, but quite easy to make. And the problematic of relationship between founder and developer, here, in the feature-oriented model, you don't have relationship between developer, and you don't have relationship between founders. And the founder can only request and contract the features they pay. They don't have a global responsibility. They think feature after feature. In a community-oriented model, here you have the possibility to request all features but pay only one part if the legal entity accepts that, basically. If I compare these two models for new development, I would say feature-oriented model is a reference, sorry. And you see several advantages and disadvantages of the community-oriented model. I believe on long term, community-oriented model is better because you create only one software, what is coherent. The risk that is less coherent on the feature-oriented model is higher. The benefit for others is also bigger because you have one coherent software, but you have some drawback from the founder perspective. Where is it? You have here some drawback. You have less control because you can only say what you want, but you don't actively participate to the development, and you have not a clear, direct contract for one feature. You have more a general view. Okay, and for OpenLayers 3, again with a Swiss topo perspective, we decided in 2012 to finance for $100,000 if a global amount of $350,000 can be found. This estimation was made by the OpenLayers steering committee that it's the amount that is needed in order to create an equivalent library equivalent to OpenLayers 2. So, and I can say that it's not easy to go to manager and simply say, well, I need 100K US dollar, and I hope to have something good at the end. So it's something that we need as open source actor. We need to improve on the management level because they simply don't understand how open source functions. But it works in the case of Systopo. And because of that, we were able to, with this follow me principle, we were able to ask Ordnance Survey, to ask IGN in France, to ask other government agency in Germany, in US. And with this support, it was possible to find 350K at the end. And it was more than 100 crowdfunders. It was individuals, companies, administration that collected this 350K. And we created a contract with a legal entity, and this legal entity was a group of main companies working in open layers, namely OpenGeo, Boundless now, Camp2Camp, and Terrestris in Germany. What was the phase? The first phase is discussion. At the beginning, I send an email to the project steering committee of OpenLayer with this idea to create a new library. Of course, they made previously already some first test with WebGL, so it started not from zero. But we try to propagate this idea of crowdfunding. Then we needed to define what was the goal. And here, the idea was really to create something equivalent to OpenLayer 2, but with modern technologies. Then we made this 1 month crowdfunding campaign. We made a contract with a legal entity, and all founders made a contract with this legal entity. And in January of this year, they started the development. And now, since 3 or 4 months, we are at Systopo using this development in order to launch a new release in October of this year. What did we learn? First, we need to think worldwide. So we had crowdfunders from all the continents, I think. Yeah, we have from Japan, we have from US, South America, I don't think so, Europe. And so we have really to think worldwide. We have really to interest people of all over the world. We need to discuss with the open source community as user. We need to go in the open source community, ask questions, discuss with the person of the open source community. We have also seen that direct and personal contacts are really efficient. Typically, my director at Systopo, Jean-Philippe Amstein, he sends 100 of mails to all his colleagues in Europe, all the persons by Ordnance Survey, because of course he has contact with the manager of this other mapping agency. And with this personal and direct contact, it was possible to find some money by other mapping agency. You will find important contribution by companies and administration. And I have also to say that the companies that I cited previously, Boundless, Camp2Camp, and Terrestris, they have also invested their own money in this development. I want to underline that. But you can find this important contribution by company and by administration. You will find less important contribution, let's say $100, $20 by individual. But these contributions are also very important. Of course, the sum is not very important. But this proves that there is an interest in the community. And so I think it was quite important to discuss with administration and company, but also to discuss with the person that are part of the community. What were the issues? This legal aspect, all companies, all government agencies, they need to have contract. It's not possible not to make a contract, or a contract based on confidence is something that doesn't exist in this world, unfortunately. So we needed to have a legal entity in order to make this contract. And another aspect, it's quite difficult to legally speaking, it's quite difficult to bind the contribution and the requirements. And this binding is basically made by the legal entity. But as Fistopo, we made a contract of 100K, and we asked for the whole package, for the complete feature parity with OL2. In parallel, Ordnance Survey did the same for another amount, but we didn't have relationship between Ordnance Survey and Swiss Topo. So the binding is made by the legal entity and is not made by the contributors. And the problem for us is that if Ordnance Survey doesn't pay anything, then we will not reach the goal, which is this feature parity. But that's the risk that we took as contributor. Okay, the result, I think you have seen that in the three last presentations. We have now a very nice release, which is not a release, or is it now?
Next couple minutes.
Netsk is working on his iPhone, so it will be done.
The last slide, and then.
Okay, but I can say we work with it since 4 months. It's already very, very good, and you can really work with it. Of course, I expect some change in the API, but it's a risk we take. And from our perspective, we will have a new geoportal based on a modern web mapping library. We believe that the perennity of this library is ensured. And we have relatively modest investment. Of course, if we decided to pay for everything, we had to pay 350K. And we only pay 100K. And now I think others can benefit of this work. And that's also the idea of open source, I think. And I will not demonstrate it, but that will be the new geoportal. Oh, it's a preview here. And here you have OpenLayer 3. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Cedric. Any questions?
What were the most important arguments to convince your decision makers in your institution?
I think it was because of OpenLayers 2, because they knew that OpenLayers 2 was successful. They knew that we were very happy with OpenLayers 2. And saying that we want to create a new library which is equivalent to that and which is made by the same person was a key argument, I think.
Two questions about the entity that you created. How much of the fundraising had to go towards overheads, like legal costs and accounting costs? And do you see the entity being a permanent thing for OpenLayers, or was it just for this funding and then it will be kind of?
I think for the legal entity is for OpenLayers 3. The overhead cost, I think maybe Claude can speak about that because he was.
Actually, there is no overhead cost that was taken from the funding money. It was supported directly by the company. So okay. My management time. So it was
an
additional
donation
in kind. Every
single dollar
goes to the development.
And I have just to precise that the founder are not part of this legal entity. The legal entity is composed really of the three companies that I mentioned. Yes. Yes?
Right. I assume the 350K are used now, and will there be another additional funding for the 3D features?
Thank you for asking, because that's clear. Now with this 350K, we will have one beta, but the goal is also to go in the 3D direction. They plan also optimization in this version. So we need more money in order to continue the work. But I think from now on, it's probably possible to go back to a feature-oriented model and to continue the development based on a feature-oriented model. But that's only my opinion. Maybe we can continue with the legal entity. For me, I have not strong opinion about that.
Was that amount already, how much of this amount was already spent?
Everything. actually, you have to take into account that if we sum up the number of hours, there's also lots of investment directly from the companies involved into the project. And individual too, because some of the contributors work a lot on their spare time too, so it's really a collaborative work.
Actually, I would think it would be good to have a lot of funding for the 3D. I mean, there's basic work to do, and you probably you don't immediately see results.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably more than one entity can handle.
Any more questions? What kind of entity you actually took, because